They said the music. Rather so the music.
Baby, it's deep. It is getting deep. It's WKCR FM New York, WKCR HD1, WKCR.org, 89.9 FM, whatever way you slice it. We are us. It's Jazz Alternatives. The show's heard each weeknight from 6 to 9 p.m. I'm Mitch Goldman. Occasionally on these Monday nights, we do this thing we call Deep Focus, and we invite a special guest into the studio. That guest chooses a topic of deep focus, and the challenge to me is to find live unreleased recordings of that artist, and we usually stick the landing. Let's see what happens. I'm very happy to welcome back to the studio Michael Dorf. Michael?
Hey, Mitch.
It's been a little minute.
I don't think I've been in this studio for over a decade.
I think it's actually a lot more
decades.
Than that. I think it's a good couple decades.
Yeah.
I think we did one of these back in the...
Well, we did a show. I don't remember it being deep focus.
No, it was not deep focus.
Because I've never had much focus to begin with, so I don't think it would be deep focus.
It was not deep focus. It was the old days. It might have even been... When I was doing the show with Ethan Singer.
Oh yeah,
try that one instead.
Yeah, has that got a little more reverb?
Oh,
is that prettier?
That's
right.
much prettier.
It's been a long time.
Yeah, I want to say. I mean, yeah, really, it's sometime back in the 1900s.
Although, how fun was that hanging out at the Newport Jazz Festival?
That was good.
It felt like you know, we're jazz guys.
we were road dogs even. Yeah. But now, Michael, okay, almost always my guest is a musician, and people are going, I don't have any Michael Dorf records. Well, you don't, but you do, because Michael has been one of the people setting the table in this town among many other towns on various continents around the globe for nearly as long as I've been listening to music. Michael just closed New York's City Winery. I'm going to ask you about that because I know there's a new, even better City Winery coming along. And before that, you were the proprietor at
It was called the Knitting Factory.
The Knitting Factory, which was this radio station's unofficial favorite venue. And for many of us who were hungry for things, nipping at the edges of different genres of music as many of the listeners are. It was the only place to be 6.5 nights out of 7. And you ran that thing for years, about mid-80s.
From the beginning of 86, 87. We opened our doors February of 87. And then I left the company when we were on Leonard Street in 2003. So 16 years. You know, I had my bar mitzvah there.
Yes. Yeah. 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 Now, I was thinking, I have a funny memory. I don't know. I'm sure you probably remember this, too. We have not talked about any of this stuff.
No, this is cool. This is pretty unscripted. The only thing we talked about was Sonny Sharrock, but we'll get
there. Well, I was just about, I'm remembering, I was thinking about how many bands you must have heard between 1987 and the last time you walked out of there, and it's got to be way up in the thousands. I mean,
oh my goodness, yes. I mean, we had three stages, and I would try and sneak a little bit of everything, and I lived inside the venue pretty much, literally. In the beginning. I literally had a futon underneath the desk in the office for the first 2 years. I went to Pineapple Fitness on Canal and Broadway to shower. It was $19.99 a month, so it was a really good deal for basically keeping clean. I used a Schwitz once in a while, but I never worked out. You know, right. They thought I was weird. But I lived inside the club. And, so I was always there.
I was remembering there was some kind of sculpture or assemblage or something that you or someone had made of...
With cassette? Well, until John Lurie knocked it down one night.
Oh, that's right.
He was climbing that wall. We would get anywhere from 25 to 40 cassettes a day. There was a window there that they wouldn't stop coming. And we tried to listen to everything. I mean, it was really important. And I did. The reason I got into the business is I was trying to get a band gigs, right? So I was on the solicitation side for a while, and I knew what it was like to not get the call back or not get the listen to or the comment, you know? And I remember making a point. I'm going to do this. I'm going to listen to every single tape that someone gives me. And I'd say for 4 or 5 years, I lived by that. At one point, it did get a little bit Meshuggah-na. And I do remember actually leaving, towards the end in 2003. And part of the reason I think I'm glad I stepped out is I had Glad bags filled with unopened mail with cassettes and CDs in it, right? So we couldn't even get we got to the point where in 2003 we couldn't even open it up.
No, and Michael's gesturing with his hands. He's not making the little sandwich bag Glad bag. No. He's making the big construction garbage bag.
Yes,
they
were
Glad bag.
They were, I actually feel bad about that because in thinking it was really about trying to listen to them all. So in the beginning, when we were on Houston Street, we had a wall. After we took over Estella's restaurant and we put that staircase, we had this, I don't know, it was about 12 feet by 14 feet tall. It was kind of the two-story connection spot between the floors. And we had so many cassettes. We're like, and they look cool, right? There are these little different spines and colors. And we got, Fish's demo tape, Harry Connick Jr. gave me a cassette. And I'm a schmuck and embarrassed because I, listened to it and I said to him, it's a little too inside New Orleans for us at the Knitting Factory. I'm sorry, man. What's your name again?
Right. Yep.
What a schmuck, right? I mean, sorry, Harry. I mean, had I known.
I think Joe Bronner was representing him too.
But when he first came up from New Orleans, he had an apartment across the street for a little bit. And anyways, so we just put all the cassettes on the wall until one, night, I forgot exactly the circumstance, but it was, our friend John Lurie
who else would it have been?
Knocked the whole thing down. It was incredible.
I forgot about that. I was a vague recollection. So literally, there had to be tens of thousands of bands that you either heard live or auditioned or whatever. And when I said to you, Michael, who are we going to do this deep focus on? There was one answer you came back with.
He lived in Ossining, I believe.
Sonny Sharrock. Yep, he did.
And I drive past Ossining, and I always think about him. And there's never been an opportunity to honor his great work and his memory and who he was. And he was, really special guy.
Well, I'll tell you something, by the way, not to interrupt, but
that's
interrupting.
Okay. You're always going to interrupt me.
When you do make it to Ossining, you must drive down Sonny Sharrock Way. There is a street name for him.
As he deserves.
The very least.
Well, when I first met him, I didn't know where Ossining was. And, I thought, who knew, somewhere upstate New York. I mean, I had never adventured north of Houston Street, And so, he's been on my mind a little bit, just thinking about there were some gentlemen, they were grandfatherly to me, right? I was 23 years old, you and I had a lot of hair back then,
we
right?
did.
We had so much hair. And, You know, and these guys, you know, probably in 1987, 88, he must have already been 45 or 50. I haven't done that calculation, but he was yeah. already a little more, you know, he was certainly mature, but he had a real gentleman sensibility. And
instead of
looking down on this kid who somehow had this venue and somehow was giving him cash, you know, to play and then record, et cetera. But he was always super respectful, and he didn't need to be. And not everybody was. I mean, like James Blood Ulmer also very much a gentleman with me. And I know. So I've been thinking about these guys and just what great humans they were, and they also happened to be these magic performers. And I don't know. So when you said let's do the show, and I was trying to, you know, I was thinking 87, 88, 89, that, you know, window, and knowing you and us, you know, all the time we spent, and I don't know, Sonny just popped out. It just seemed like such a natural. And when you said, yeah, we've never done a Sonny Sharrock show, I was like, it's perfect.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I played some with Melvin Gibbs, but I don't know if we did a complete show. I think it was anyway. He was an absolutely singular musician. Nobody sounded, or to this day, sounds like him. And as you said, I mean, he was profoundly warm, thoughtful person, but he was also deeply cynical and hilarious.
Funny. Real funny guy. Yep.
And it always seemed to come from this kind of rueful sort of his sense about the world, you know? I mean, the real Sonny, though, emerged when he was playing. It was always a treat. And so, yeah, you threw the challenge down, and I'm stepping up, man. Found some great live recordings of Sonny that almost no one's ever heard, and there might be a super duper rare, unusual surprise coming soon.
Well, too. If we can get the DAT player to work, I did bring a DAT tape from that 1988 period when he must have done 6-7 nights that year.
Yeah, it seemed like he was playing all the time, and he had an incredible band. Melvin Gibbs always playing bass. Two drummers, Abe Speller and
Faron Akaloff.
Faron, and then Lance Carter.
Right.
Later,
right.
I think, and Sonny ripping it on guitar. So I'm gonna actually pull a little bit of a spontaneous choice here, and see if we can get that DAT playing.
Okay.
So I'm going to play this. This is a short set, but a great one. This is from the Wilshofen Jazz Festival, June of 1991. And it is exactly that band, Melvin Gibbs on bass, Faron Akaloff, and Abe Speller on drums. And also in 91, so this is a couple of years later, we're going to get to some of the 1988 stuff in a bit. But Dave Snyder's added on keys, and it's all Sonny ripping on the guitar. So, shall we?
I would love to hear it.
You ready?
Yeah, baby.
Turn it up if you can. If you're someplace where you can really let it rip, do yourself a favor and bring it up to Sharrock volume. Music from Sonny Sharrock live from the WKCR archives in Wilshofen, Germany, June 1991. It's Deep Focus. I'm Mitch Goldman. Michael Dorf is my guest. WKCR.
Letztes, das letzte von 24 Konzerten.
We could hear that, but see, that's just proof. In case you didn't believe me. I didn't see that's because I told that.
Yeah.
We'll fix this in post-production. Don't worry. We'll take care of this. But
I thought this was live.
Oh, that's right. All right. Well, see, it is. It's from our great thanks to the German broadcast radio folks.
Yep.
Did a great job with this.
Yeah, it's Bitch, ain't it? We're having a good time. On keyboards, Mr. Dave Snyder. Lance Carter on drums. The bass player that used to work with is Mr. Charles Baldwin. And our founder and godfather and all that, Abe Speller.
is how it rolled out. And that was Sonny Sharrock, the great Sonny Sharrock. And
he just wailed.
He did.
Does he just? He just. It's just a. It was power guitar.
Yeah.
So loud.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
I just loved listening to him.
There we go. I wasn't hearing myself. That was a problem. I always want to hear myself. Yeah. I said, you know, I think I used the wrong word. I think I said cynicism to describe Sonny Sharrock. It wasn't cynicism. It was like a, and I'm talking about when he wasn't playing this kind of dark humor. But I, you know, when he's playing, he's a true believer, man. He's in his thing, and it's real, and it's just so, yeah, unrestrained, unfiltered. It's.
And I wonder. I mean, so he was diabetic.
Yes.
And he didn't eat well at all.
Yeah.
And I wonder. If he just felt like every day was his last, and he played like it, and he would go on stage, and he didn't know if he would be back tomorrow,
yeah,
and so he put it out there, like there was no tomorrow, right?
Yeah,
and he did that every day, and thank goodness he did last for a while.
Yeah,
you know, certainly died prematurely, but
yeah,
he played hard,
younger than we are now.
Ooh, God, that's strange.
It is. And he, we just, I love the guy. I love the guy. I did get to spend a lot of time with him. We were on the road together. And when you're on the road with somebody, as you know, stuff comes out. Good and bad. I never wanted to talk to that guy again. Sometimes you're saying about somebody that you sat next to in a van for a week or whatever. Sonny was just the always perspective and finding the humor in things and warmth and would talk about, if you asked him a question, you got an answer to that question.
Mm-hmm. Did you go on that Northwest tour thing with the, you know, where we had three groups of the Knitting Factory?
I remember that. No.
But that wasn't the tour you were talking about.
No, I did. I took Sonny out with Last Exit with Ronald Shannon Jackson, Bill Laswell.
Yeah.
And Peter Brotzman.
And to Europe or U.S.?
U.S. Did I think I try to remember. I must have done some stuff. Must have done some stuff in Europe with them,
right,
too.
And we only did that once, right? We had one
Knitting
Factory.
At the Knit,
date.
We did them one time. They only played the Knitting Factory one time. That was February 4th, 1988. Mm. And I could tell you what we settled up for that night.
I don't remember. It was probably 75% of the gate where it came out.
No, it was hard guarantee on that one,
yeah,
actually.
But I tried to compute it as 75% of the gate.
And then I never saw the place more crowded than it was that night. But that kind of became a legendary show. People still talk about it. If you Google it, you might see something about it. That and the night before, we did Johnny D's in Boston.
In Boston.
Yeah. But they were that band was a piece of work to work with. It was kind of a super group. And Sonny was always cool. He was always the same. And it's funny, the first time that I met Sonny was, I'm saying right here in the studios, WKCR, although they weren't here. It was another building standing here at the time. But he came by himself. This was 1985. Hmm. And he had done a lot by that time. He had a bunch of records out under his own name. He was, you know, he's played with Miles Davis. He played with Herbie Mann for quite a while. He was known.
Yeah.
And but he'd been off the scene for years. And he came by himself, just him and his guitar and his amp, and he just sat down, put his amp on the floor, and I think he was sitting on his amp actually and playing solo to some like tape loops and stuff. And you know, it was the same. And then he, I don't know exactly how far it went, but he had some success kind of in the jam band scene, didn't he? Like towards the end, I think he was doing a lot of those big festival and events and stuff. I mean, like, he became, he wasn't a superstar in the Madonna sense at that time, but he was known.
I think, if I recall, like, Thurston Moore and the Sonic Youth guys really used to come and watch him and then, you know, revered, and his name started to get into that rock world, and then that might have connected to, like, the Beck scene a little bit, early Beck.
I thought he was more doing, like, I don't know if he did the Horde tour or, like, some of that, you know, like, that jam band stuff really was taken off at that time. And I think, anyway, doesn't matter. But my point is, he would have been the same guy playing the same music either way. Well, I became a super Sonny Sharrock fan, and I think you did too, during a whole series of shows that he did at the Knitting Factory. In particular, I remember things coming together there, like, I want to say 87, 88, 89.
Yeah, I mean, 88 was, for me, the prime. That was the year I remember Sonny. And then, frankly, Melvin Gibbs, who was there once a week, you know, with all kinds of other groups.
Like, right. his groups,
and he played with so many different people.
Yeah.
I had no idea, you know, the incestuousness of the scene. I mean, 87, my eyes were getting open, but 88, we were now really deep in it, and everyone's playing with everybody, and the influence from one to another. It was such a fertile time, so fertile. And Melvin was one of those guys who just played with everybody, and he could, you know, jam hard with Sonny and some what felt like songs. And then all of a sudden he's doing all kinds of odd improv, and then he's doing his own material, soft sometimes, and very melodic and just very versatile.
Yeah. Well, he was anchor of that band. Well, we have a recording of one of those shows from April 1988, and I'm going to guess, I think this was, did he do like Friday, Saturday weekends? Was that?
It was always such an interesting negotiation on what nights. I mean, it got to a point where it just didn't matter, right?
Yeah.
Monday, Tuesday would be as crazy as Friday, Saturday. And then it got to a point where Friday, Saturday was just so overwhelming that, you know, if you were as popular as Sonny, you'd start to want to move to like Wednesday, Thursday, because it just got more comfortable. And I liked it because then I could put something that maybe wasn't as strong a draw
right
on the Friday, Saturday, knowing that it would balance out, because we could only squeeze 100 and something into the room.
That's true.
Although we had like 310 for Les Exit or the Violin Femmes or some of the John Zorn stuff.
Yeah. It was – now, you know, in fairness to people – okay, so – if you're just joining us, my name is Mitch Goldman. It's WKCR. The show's called Deep Focus. And Michael Dorf is my guest, and our focus is on the magnificent Sonny Sharrock. Michael owned the Knitting Factory at the time that we're talking about, 80s, 90s, and beyond. And now there is a place in Brooklyn called the Knitting Factory.
Yes.
That's not the place we're talking
about.
And
I have no connection to it. I got out in 03. I feel glad it's around, and my baby and the brand and the name is still around. I'm very proud of it, but it is a completely – this is where I believe you are going there.
Go on.
It is a completely different music vibe, and it's a different time. You know, Brooklyn is a very vibrant, you know, place now. Actually, maybe even – it's already – beyond its time. Most of what we see of Brooklyn, Williamsburg, et cetera, is already too fancy compared to what Houston Street was in 1988. You know, it was dirty. The scene was colliding, right? You had the old jazz cats watching and listening and playing with some of the newer avant-garde cats. You had black artists with white artists. You had, you know, a influence of international and punk. You know, the Bowery was a half a block away. In fact, I bought my first DAP machine on the Bowery for $100, And within a week, the entire venue at the time, we got everything stolen, if you remember.
Yes, I do.
And it was the last time I ever bought anything hot and really learned my karma, you know, lesson there. You know, you're going to buy something stolen, it's going to come back, you're going to get it stolen. So, but that was the introduction of the DAT machine. I really needed to want to have a DAT. But everything was colliding at the same time. Yeah. It was a very fertile, incredible time. I miss that. You know, I miss New York. It's hard to see those scenes anymore. It's very rare.
So this was Houston Street between Mott and Mulberry, was it?
Between Mott and Mulberry.
And it was really, it was just a little storefront. And in 88, it was just above street level.
It was the upstairs. It was an old Avon office. We paid $1,800 a month for a couple thousand square feet of a loft. Within about 8 months, Estella's Peruvian restaurant below couldn't take it any longer. The noise that was going down there, and she wasn't doing that good, but we were just all over her place. So we ended up taking over her lease very quickly. And then we started making some crazy noise, really loud. The building was shaking, and the family that was living on the second floor moved out. And basically the landlord, this guy Peter Goodman, I haven't seen him in a long time, said, "Dorf, you're taking the second floor." And so that became, actually for me, it was exciting. It was my first real apartment, but it became our office and Sun Ra's lounge and Cecil Taylor's hangout. But, I mean, it was right above the club. And so we had basically the three floors. And then Ray Ross was above us, the great jazz photographer.
Yeah.
So it was a pretty crazy building. You know, the mob was right around the corner. You know, pretty much the first 3-4 years, that was still very much that you know, family business scene. The street was filled with a lot of people that were living on the street, and the East Village had a lot of, you know, I mean, it was the movement. There was not, you know, what is it? It's Nolita now.
No.
It's none of that. I mean, it was really gritty and fantastic.
Yeah. And a little Shkivatz.
Whatever the hell that Yiddish is. I mean, you know, but it was really, it was an artistic dirt.
Yeah.
I haven't seen in a while.
And you had emerging DJ culture. You had like all these other like just subgenres stepping on each other and mixing up, grinding against each other. And it was thrilling.
It was really cool to see, you know, David Byrne checking things out and it informing, you know, someone as big as him in pop music.
But it was for all of this, and it became a global brand thanks to your efforts. But I was going to say, despite all that, it was still a hole in the wall.
it was a legit hole in the wall and unsafe. Yeah. You know, from a building code perspective, one of the reasons I wanted to move to Leonard Street, and then our original marketing when we moved to Leonard Street in 1994 was the safest club in New York, because I was so proud of the fact that it actually had sprinklers, it had pull down boxes, it had the proper exits. You know, when we took over Estella's, we didn't want to rip out the acoustic ceiling, so what we did is we went to Goodwill and we bought 100 sweaters for $1, and then we cut them in half. A guy named Dan Bodner helped, and we basically knit them together and made a ceiling out of sweaters. And then the fire department came in, and we had now sprayed the sweaters with this really toxic, bad fire retardant thing that would then drip. After we'd spray the ceiling, it would drip for a day down, you know, and like I sometimes see drips and there's customers with a glass of beer. And it's like, oh my God, what's going on? But the fire department came in and, you know, tried to light it on fire, and a couple of times successfully would get a little bit going. I mean, the whole place, you could see when there was 150 or more upstairs, the ceiling was pushed coming down. And it's like, it was really important to move into a place that was going to be safe, because I could
not. Should we talk about the bathrooms?
Please. I avoided our bathrooms. That's why I went to Pineapple Fitness around the corner. Good but move. You probably experienced that.
Yeah, not good.
Yeah, no, they were bad. Yeah. If you could imagine the worst New York City restroom, tiny little thing.
CBGB this was still had you.
Yeah, but CB's was a little bit bigger, and you'd expect it of I mean, that was like part of it. You know, I mean, you got to learn that ours were terrible too, but they were really atrocious.
They were bad.
Yeah.
They were bad.
Yeah.
But so this is the environment. And again, small. How wide was it from in the performance?
20 space? Feet wide, 22 yeah. feet, you know, with the stairwell, and then about 100 feet deep. So it was about 2,000 square feet. And, you know, every couple of weeks, we were knocking out little walls wherever we could just to find space. I mean, we looked for every ounce of space. And in 94, again, it was so exciting to move into a new place. I mean, but before the old Knit, when we took over Estella's, we tried to be a restaurant, actually. So we there was a kitchen. The problem is the chef was a junkie for the first month and a half. So it, between not being able to manage, not being able to cook myself, really, and it didn't work. So we sold all of the kitchen equipment to one of our neighbors. He tried to open up a restaurant with it somewhere else. And now we had this empty room, which became our first alternative second space. We called it, I believe, the Knot Room.
Indeed.
And, I mean, the craziest stuff went on in there. I wish I could remember half of it.
Well, just in case, by the way, any of the gang from back then are catching this, especially Bob Appel.
Yeah.
A little shout out, a little nod, tip of the hat.
I just saw Bob, you know, really? And I would say that that tape was probably recorded by Bob. I mean, if it wasn't for Bob, who was a real musician, I mean, I always wanted to be in the band. He was in the band that I was, you know, managing and you know, he was getting girls in high school and I wasn't, right? So I that's what I really wanted to be. But thank goodness for Bob, right? He worked the board, and so we had good sound for a small little room. And then as we started getting into recording, Bob, it was really his affinity, and he did some incredible stuff, early pioneering with a DAT machine and then the multi-track, you know, digital audio tape. That was pretty wild stuff. And we built our first studio, you know, at the old Knit on the second floor, and you know, he was very much a part of it. So I'm certain that I brought had his handwriting on it.
But we're not going to play it. not because of
the
anything.
The DAT actually is still working. It's your DAT machines.
It is, you know? Our DAT machines.
You got to send some money to WKCR and get some new DAT machines.
That's right. You're listening to WKCR. I'm Mitch Goldman, my guest, Michael Dorf, and we are in deep focus on the great Sonny Sharrock. So we've just set the scene for you down at 47 East Houston Street. Building's still there if you want to go stand in front of it and gaze. And so if you look up to the floor above street level, there's big picture window, mm-hmm. and the stage was just
right there.
So the musicians would have their back to the street. Although mm-hmm. I think you had a big
trip. We had a curtain up.
And so that is the scene. Abe Speller and Firon Akhlof are the drummers. Melvin Gibbs on the bass and the magnificent Sonny Sharrock playing guitar. Michael, is there anything else to be said?
Well, the door that you walked in walked right past the stage. And so I could stand in that doorway, and it was the best seat in the house. And then eventually when we got Estella's, you went downstairs and then up the back, which was much better than walking basically right in front of the stage to get in.
Yeah.
So
it was only
a short window that we had people come up those steps and right next to the stage. But then it became just an emergency exit. But for me to be able to stand right there and almost be on the stage was always one of the most exciting spots to see some powerful music.
It's April 21st, 1988. I can smell it now. This is Sonny Sharrock at the Knitting Factory in New York City on WKCR FM New York, WKCR HD1. Mm-hmm. Fret not, listener. There is plenty more of this show. We've got another couple of hours of it. You're listening to Deep Focus from August 5th, 2019. Michael Dorf, my guest, on the topic of the fantastic Sonny Sharrock. Sharrock, S-H-A-R-R-O-C-K. And you absolutely want to have some of his music in your collection. I wish I could say he was still around doing it, but his music still exists. And if you're just finding out about it from this show, by all means, seek and ye shall find some terrific recordings of the fantastic Sonny Sharrock. If you are just discovering this podcast, you should subscribe. You can find us probably on your favorite podcasting app. You can always get us on the hosting site, which is mitchgoldman.podbean.com. And if you're digging it, let folks know. It'll be great service to us if you tell a friend who loves music, or just give us a thumbs up or five stars or whatever. And that's going to help people who have not heard of this show find out about it, because it's, you know, they've got those algorithms. It's going to make it pop up for someone who's maybe inclined to like this music but doesn't know about Deep Focus. So that'll be a huge service to us. That's my computer, not yours. Okay, I'm going to see you over at part two of this Sonny Sharrock program. It's Deep Focus. I'm your host, Mitch Goldman.